Wednesday at 5:30 on WUSF-TV, a service of the University of South Florida, presenting information through educational, public affairs, and how-to programming. WUSF-TV, Tampa, St. Petersburg.
Funding for Tracks Ahead is provided in part by the Kalmbach Publishing Company, publishers of classic toy trains, Trains Model Railroader, and Trains Illustrated.
Tracks Ahead introduces Circus Trains, Russ Porter, Railroad Artist, Brad Nelson, American Flyer Layout, and the Indianapolis Children's Museum.
Hello, I'm Chuck Zehner, and I'd like to personally welcome you to Tracks Ahead. During the golden era of the circus, thousands of people, young and old alike, would gather at the train depot early in the morning to see the arrival of the circus train. Ordinary crossings and sidings became a place of wonder as that magnificent and colorful circus train came into view with wonders from the four corners of the globe. Millions of Americans remember well the unloading of a circus train.
In the 1930s, the Ringling Brothers Barnum and Bailey Circus moved on usually 90 railroad cars. These 90 railroad cars carried 160 wagons on the flat cars, 30 to 40 elephants, depending upon the season. It varied from year to year. And probably 180 baggage horses, the term baggage being synonymous with draft horses. There were also performing horses in addition to those 180 draft horses. In addition, there were also 1,200 employees that lived on the train as it moved from town to town. In a given season, the circus train would travel from 12,000 to 18,000 miles, depending on whether they went to the West Coast and how far they spread it out. On a given day in that season, they could travel as short a distance as 40 miles and as long a distance as 200. The circus train comprised four types of railroad cars. There were 40 flat cars, which carried the wagons and wheeled vehicles at the circus. There were stock cars, which carried both elephants and horses. Also the lead stock, which were the camels, the llamas, the zebras, the non-caged, non-ferocious animals. There were 25 coaches on which the 1,200 employees stayed and slept. And there were two advance cars, which went from 2 to 3 weeks ahead of the show with the bill posters, press agents, and advance crews to do the advance advertising for the circus. The circus train traveled each day in four sections. The first section, which was nicknamed the Flying Squadron, carried the layout department, the stake and chain, the menagerie department, the cookhouse department, and some miscellaneous equipment. The second section was the last one loaded in the old town, and it was it carried the big top and the sideshow and some miscellaneous equipment. The third section was called the lumber train because of the predominance of seats on it. It carried the seating, the properties, the rigging, the hardware of the big top and the circus. The fourth section had no flat cars and was all stock cars and coaches carrying performing horses, personnel, staff, and elephants, performing elephants. The interesting part about the Flying Squadron is it left the old town while the evening performance was still taking place on its way to the new town. Therefore, what it carried was not necessary for the performance. When the circus train arrived in a new town, The train was unloaded by a ramp, or what the circus called runs, erected at one end of a string of flat cars. The crossover place between the flat cars were made a little bridge by which the wheeled wagons could move the length of a string of flat cars, pulled by horses pulling by rope from the ground. The wagons were held in place on the flat cars while the train was in motion by wedged spiked wood blocks holding and controlling the movement of the wheels. These had to be removed. Then when the wagon was rolling off the flat car, down the runs, it was a braking device, a rope braking device, worked off the back end of each car, of each wagon, looped around an iron post anchored to the flat car, which controlled its downhill speed.
Wisconsin railroad artist Russ Porter's interest in trains stems from his early boyhood. Russ seriously began painting trains in 1939, and today, Russ is not only well known on the national level, but international level as well, for accuracy and detail in his railroad paintings.
I first began painting seriously back in 1939, and I had been to various exhibits and so forth, model layouts, the World's Fair in Chicago, especially in 1933. They had a beautiful old gauge layout there, and that's what got me really started. I research railroads, trains, you might say ships. I have a collection of 60,000 color slides of the various subjects, and then I go to the museums and so forth. And my clients look for accuracy in a painting, realism, and something that's sort of dramatic. Paintings in my studio, I have two of them up in the wall, and they're both ship paintings. That's a little bit on the side from railroad paintings, but the one shows a Green Bay and Western locomotive loading cars into a car ferry at Kewaunee. And the other one, of course, is the Christopher Columbus, the only whaleback passenger ship on the Great Lakes. And I have a painting in progress on my easel, which shows the Soo Line passenger train sitting at the Duluth, Minnesota depot. And it's going to be a winter scene, and it'll be night. My Pullman Palace car was built in 1901. And the first president had it for about 30 years. It was designed specially for him. And they retired it in 1957, and we bought it in 1963, had it moved up to our lot near Wisconsin Dells. And we've had a studio built over it, plus a long train shed to protect it from the elements. What you would see on the tour of the private car would be, first of all, the dining lounge, which is very elaborate. It has these old gas lights that have been converted to electricity, two of those in the ceiling. Next, you see the kitchen. And next to that is the porter room. No relation, but they had a porter and a chef who took care of the wants of the president and his guests. And from there, you went into the Compartment A, which has an upper and lower berth. From there, you went into the president's room, which is very elaborate. It has a bronze plate on the door that says president. It had a brass bed at one time. And from there, you go into the aisle, into the general washroom, which still has its nickel silver sink. And the last compartment would be one that they added to the car in 1951. And that's sort of a roomette. And from there we go into the lounge, which faces the brass railed platform. I still have in my possession a rough sketch that I made when I was 7 years old, and my dad saved it for me, and it showed the Northwestern steam locomotive in the yard, which was very close to our home. And from there, that's what started me out in pencil sketching and so forth.
We were looking for a fundraiser to raise money to build this depot. And so many people had seen this beautiful painting that Russ had done for me a number of years ago. that they said, boy, I'd like to have a copy of that. And we've never been able to figure out what to do. And I thought, hey, how about having a lithograph made? Maybe I could talk Russ into signing it and numbering it, because I understand these things are go pretty well as fundraisers. And I called Russ up, and he says, sure, he'd be glad to do it, because he knew how badly we needed a depot here, and he had a great love and interest of railroading and passenger railroading in particular. And he said, I'll be glad to do it. And our first day of sale was to be at the local bank here in town. And Mr. Porter very graciously agreed to come up here and sign autographs, help us sell the prints, display pictures that he had made for other people. He went out and borrowed them, actually, of these beautiful railroad paintings that he's done. He'd borrow them back and then put them on display. So he really put on quite a show here. But as a result of all these prints that Russ signed, 1,200 of them, he must have spent wore his hand out, we were off to a real flying start, which has culminated in actually building a depot here. We've just been most fortunate to have had all this cooperation from Russ, because I don't think this depot would have ever been built if it hadn't been this. We'd have probably been out having bake sales for the next 50 years if it wasn't for this print that he had.
My favorite railroad, and we would have to call it past because it was the Milwaukee Road, which has been absorbed into the Soo Line. And my foreign railroad, a favorite railroad, is the Algoma Central in Canada. My favorite railroad painting would be the 1935 Hiawatha coming through Sturtevant, Wisconsin. The picture of the train with all the smoke coming out of it, passing the depot, and the old hotel in the background. That hotel was a nice spot to eat in between trains, of course. They had most delicious hamburgers. But the just the scene, which you can still see today, the depot is still standing there, and the old hotel is still standing there. But that was, I'd say, my most enjoyable painting to do.
Brad Nelson of Waukesha, Wisconsin, is an American Flyer model railroader. Brad's model railroad features Lionel and American Flyer accessories, a double-track main line with mountain scenery and very interesting structures as well. Brad's model railroad is definitely in a class by itself.
I received my first train set at Christmas time when I was about 8 years old. It was a wind-up Mark set, and I just loved it. And I got tired of winding the engine up after a while, so next Christmas I begged for an electric train, and I received another electric train Mark set. And that was about it until I was a freshman in high school. Then I bought my first American Flyer set, which was a 322 Hudson, because I liked realism and a two-rail track. That about put me in the Flyer.
The size of Brad's layout is 24 feet by 14 feet. The construction is pretty much tabletop rather than open framework. Oh, he's had to cut out in several places for the gorges, but it provides a good base for the accessories and track. For about 350 feet of track, which includes the main line and sidings. Track is all soldered together for smooth running. Brad used about 25 American Flyer switches combined with Gargrave's track. On the layout, there is a mixture of steam and diesel locomotives. The freight cars are mostly new Lionel cars, but there are some original Flyer cars as well. Unlike most Flyer collection, Brad wants his trains to run, rather than sit on a shelf. The mountains and hills were added on the top using plaster. There are lots of trees on this layout, and the forest looked very realistic. Like most non-scale layouts, there is a lot of scenery jammed into a small area. So it was easy to mix a village with industry and include things that you normally wouldn't find side by side in real life. There are a lot of industrial scenes to show off those operating accessories. There is a milk loader, an oil derrick, water tower, and a lot of things that break up the monotony of just having a train run in a circle. For example, a log loader loads logs on a car, which can be delivered to a sawmill. Boards can then be delivered to a lumber yard in the city. The coal loaders work in the same way. Coal can be delivered to one and loaded into a car. The car can be delivered to another place for unloading and loading into a truck. There is also much activity on the layout. The drum loader can load the freight cars. Magnetic crane can load and unload scrap. The track gang can actually stop a train. Brad has a mixture of Lionel Flyer and Mark's accessories. He's not real particular about having Flyer only and uses whatever fits best on the layout. There are several scratch-built structures on the layout. One of Brad's friends built some of them, like the station and coal terminal. Brad built the attention-getting bridges out of wood and plastic and thinks that everybody is always interested in seeing the trains go over a river or gorge or something else. There are some plastic structures, but the scratch-built are easier to weather and look more realistic on the layout. Four trains can be run at once. Having several trains moving at the same time is more exciting and breaks up the monotony of just having the train go around and around. You can also be working a train in the yards while the mainline trains are also in operation. Brad likes American Flyer because it's realistic. It's 3/16 scale, and if blown up, it would be the same as a real train. The two-rail track, the smoke, and choo-choo sound make it very realistic, and also worm drive motors give lots of power to those long trains run on this railroad.
My advice to modders is get a good track plan. Have patience. Get your track work down good. Get the curves nice and smooth. Solder the joints. Get your plan for your accessories. If your train doesn't run right, it doesn't look right.
The Children's Museum in Indianapolis, Indiana is one of the largest children's museums in the world today. Ives, American Flyer, Lionel, Bing, Marks, Markland are names that truly capture the attention of museum visitors in the world's largest collection of toy trains on public display. A magnificent 1,000-square-foot Lionel layout is also equally popular with museum visitors.
The Children's Museum of Indianapolis is the largest of its kind in the world at more than 300,000 square feet. It was founded in 1925 and opened officially to the public in 1926 and has grown over the years to become one of the most 20 visited museums in the country. In 1986, we hosted more than 1.6 million visitors. One of the most popular areas in the museum is the Toy Train Treasures exhibit, and one of the most fascinating parts of that is our toy train layout. You'll see children and their families from all over the world amazed when they see the layout and the collection that we have.
One of the most popular components of our Toy Train Treasures exhibit is the O-gauge layout, and it's an extensive structure. It's 30 by 30 foot layout. We run about five trains at a time on three tracks, three levels of tracks. We have 900 feet of track on the layout. The layout features a variety of different kinds of scenes. We have, there's a town, there's a circus scene, there's a mine with a miner's cabin, there's an airport. My favorite component of the scene is the freight yard, because we display at the freight yard most of the rolling stock that we can't run on the layout. We have things that I particularly like the roundhouse on that freight yard layout. The layout was built in 1976, and it was designed by a local fella who has a train shop in town named Les Gordon. And then we had two contract workers that built the layout, and it took them about 7 months to put it together. And really, at the construction phase, the most impressive to watch was the building of the mountains and the platform part of the layout. The layout is controlled from a tower, and the unique thing about our tower is that it really looks like a train control tower. And from that tower, not only are the five trains run, but we can also control the light level so that it can become dark on the layout, and the children really enjoy that, you know, becoming night and day on the layout. They have a great deal of fun with that. The maintenance of the trains is amazing, because we spend about $4,000 a year maintaining the rolling stock. Our trains run, particularly in the summer, 7 days a week, 7 hours a day, and you can imagine that that's a lot of strain on a toy train. I mean, usually your home toy trains do not run that length of time, and so After about a week of running, the trains are taken off the layout and completely cleaned and reworked. And we get we are an authorized Lionel service station, although we only service our own trains. And so we get many of our parts from them. We purchase a lot of things at flea markets and train shows also to run on the layout. Toy Train Treasures is a really unique display because it is the largest collection of toy trains on public display in the country. It is approximately, I would say we have 12 to 1300 sets, close to 6,000 individual pieces. And it was great fun for me to work on that exhibit because I started out not knowing anything about toy trains. And as I was doing the research and really getting a background in history of toy trains and that kind of thing, it was wonderful to work with this collection because I would be reading about something that was just rare and important and incredible, and literally the next day as I was unpacking this collection, I'd find it. It would be like, oh my gosh, here's what I just read about. Isn't this neat? And we really do have some very fine and rare pieces. The collection was a combination of two collections, one that came to us in 69 from a local fellow named Noble Bidinger, and the other came to us in 74 from a fellow from Anderson, Indiana named Bob Vickers. And after we acquired Vickers' collection, he started collecting trains again almost immediately. But he would always come in, and as I was learning about trains, he really took me through a lot of it and was kind of a mentor on toy train collecting. And he would say, every time we would get to a really fine piece, he would say, I'll never be able to find this again. And really, the collection is primarily pre-war. We have an extensive collection of Lionel, American Flyer, and Ives, which are known really as the big three of American manufacturers, although we have a variety of other manufacturers of American trains and foreign trains as well. Some of the really fine pieces in the Ives section, we have a white retailer's display set where it's a white standard gauge train that was produced just for the retailer as a display model, and generally they were not sold, although obviously after the retailers were done with them, they would sell them, and that's how that one ended up getting into the hands of a child and then ultimately to the collector. Another interesting set in the Ives line was a set that was produced in 1929, and it was called the Prosperity Special. And ironically, the set was issued about 2 months before the crash. And reportedly, there were only about two dozen of those sets made. And at the time, it sold for $100, which when you think back to 1929, that was a lot of money. And to have it be called the Prosperity Special is just, you know, the ultimate in irony. In the Lionel trains, I think some of my favorites are the larger, finer standard gauge sets, the state sets particularly. Lionel came out with the first state set that they offered, and it was called a state set. Actually, it was called the Transcontinental Limited, but it became the state set just because collectors kind of coined that because there were the names of states on the cars that this train supposedly ran through on its mythical run across country. The green state set was the one that was issued first, and the thing that's kind of interesting about that set is that the train, the locomotive that pulled that train was a single engine locomotive, and they discovered after they issued it that the locomotive was not strong enough to pull these heavy cars. It's a 9-foot long set once you get it on the track. And so it was only issued in that single engine locomotive for the 1 year, and then the next year it came out with a double engine locomotive, and it was a brown set after that. American Flyer trains, some of the really prime pieces that we have are the President Special, which came out in the 20s, and it was followed the following year by, and I can't remember exactly, one of them was the Improved President Special, and then there was the Advanced President Special, and then the really finest in that line of American Flyer trains was the Mayflower. And the Mayflower was actually a President Special that was cadmium plated. And again, there were only about 100 of those trains produced. And this was again in the late 1920s, and it sold for $100. So you can imagine, it wasn't like people were rushing to the stores to buy those. I have a personal favorite, really. The steam trains are my favorite, and I think part of it is just being a mom to look at the steam trains and realize that people were letting their kids play with these. They are alcohol burners. They have a series of wicks in the engine, and depending on how fast you wanted the train to go, you would light however many wicks you wanted. But I cringe at thinking of these alcohol burners running over people's oriental carpets in the 1870s. And the cars in the steam trains have to be very light because there's not a lot of power. And so my favorite one is a little Beggs Live steamer that has cardboard lithographed cars. Another interesting thing about the collection, when you look at the foreign trains, is that the foreign trains produced for the foreign market look different because they don't have cow catchers. And in the United States, with the trains running along the open ranges as they did, they really needed a cow catcher. So many times you will see a foreign train where it will be the same train but produced for the American market, they've added a cow catcher, and produced for the European market, it is left off. A couple of other really fine trains in the collection are ones that are favorites of mine. One is the Boucher Blue Comet, and that was a train that was produced in the 20s. Boucher is a company out of New York. And the thing that I find most interesting about that one is that this train weighs a ton. I remember unpacking it and trying to get it out of the box. And it's real deceptive. It's the only twin-engine steam train ever produced. And it's a real long set, again. But to lift out the cars, which are relatively lightweight, and then get to the bottom of the box and try to get the engine out of the box was unreal. And I couldn't help thinking, you know, no child could ever lift this set. If this train came off the track while he was running it, he'd have a real hard time. Another one that I really enjoy are the Buddy L trains. Buddy L was a train that was produced in the 20s. And it was literally a floor train or a yard train. They would set up this set, and it was like a riding toy for kids. They could sit on it. They were even strong enough to have an adult sit on. And we have one in the exhibit that is mounted on the floor so that the kids can try it out and sit on it and run it back and forth. The thing that makes the toy trains really so exciting for me is the relationship between the train and the real thing. When I was in elementary school, we lived close enough to a freight line that ran near us that we kids would go down and wait for the train. We knew what times it came by and we'd wait for it. And one summer, a friend and I made signs, literally, that we would run down and hold up these signs to the engineer that said, "Hello, my name is Judy," and this friend did the same. And by the end of the summer, I mean, the engineer really knew us, and it was getting close to the end of the summer. And when he came by, he had a sign also, and it said, "Hi, my name is Bill. I'll miss you." I think he knew we were going back to school. And it was fun for me because that summer, that winter, at Christmas, my grandfather gave me a train set. So that was really an important part of toy trains for me, is the personal part of it.
Well, that's it. And I hope to see you next time on Tracks Ahead, when once again, we'll take a look at the color, excitement, and history of America's railroads.
If he can find it.
"You will pay me $100 a week, and I will bring you news."
Evelyn Waugh's Scoop, next on Masterpiece Theater.
Tuesday night at 9. A service of the University of South Florida, presenting information through educational, public affairs, and how-to programming. WUSF-TV, Tampa, St. Petersburg.
Funding for Tracks Ahead is provided in part by the Kalmbach Publishing Company, publishers of classic toy trains, Trains Model Railroader, and Trains Illustrated.
Ahead introduces the famous Moffett Tunnel, Jim Scribbins, railroad author, Walters Manufacturing, and Ward Kimball, famous toy train collector.
Hello, I'm Chuck Zehner, and I'd like to personally welcome you to Tracks Ahead. The Moffett Tunnel route of the Denver and Rio Grande Railroad operates through some of the most difficult terrain in the United States today. The Moffett Tunnel was 48 months in construction and officially opened for business in 1928. Cost of construction exceeded $15 million. And during World War II, as many as 30 trains a day passed through this famous piece of railroad real estate.
The Moffett Tunnel was drilled under the Continental Divide to eliminate 31 miles of steep mountainous grades, 4% over Rawlins Pass. The Denver and Salt Lake Railroad operated over this mountainous pass from 1904 to 1928 and had many operating problems. Mainly the steep grades required helper engines. The snow conditions in the winter required snow sheds to be built over the top of the mountain. There were 9 miles of continuous snow sheds on top of the mountain, and they had planned for another 9 miles to be built, but that was never completed. Well, that was the reason for building the tunnel. Now, the tunnel was drilled through the mountain, and the first thing they did was drill a pioneer bore, which is a tunnel to the left of the main tunnel. Now, this pioneer bore was about 10 feet in diameter. That's what it finished up to be. And it was drilled through the mountain, and then from several points within the mountain, they drilled side tunnels into the main railroad bore and had several headings working all at the same time in the main bore. And they hauled the rock that was cut away, they hauled it out through the pioneer bore and dumped it out at the east end of the tunnel here. And some was dumped at the west end as well. Now the tunnel, when they were boring it, they did have some water problems leaking in the center, about the center of the bore, and they felt this water came from a lake that was on top of the mountain. And to try to stop the water leak, they hauled boxcar loads of baled cotton to the top of the mountain and then carted it back to this lake and submerged the cotton bales in the lake, hoping it would stop the water flow. But as it turned out, it didn't work like a cork in a sink. They continued to have leaks. And they finally had to solve the problem by building a concrete liner around the railroad tunnel at this leaking area. One of the advantages of this tunnel was that it has a rather constant temperature, between 58 and 59 degrees. And it was an ideal spot for one of the early applications of continuous welded rail. It is working that way today. The Rio Grande Railroad operates several types of trains through the tunnel today. The only passenger trains are the California Zephyr, operated by Amtrak and over the Rio Grande Railroad. And then one other passenger train is the Rio Grande Ski Train that runs from Denver to Winter Park. And then, of course, we have one of our hotshot freight trains is our Railblazer, that is a piggyback type operation, short, fast train concept, express type service. And then there are many unit trains, the coal trains being the main ones, of course. We have two or three of them that operate, and we have other trains, grain trains and containerized type shipments and stuff. So we have a lot of trains that do run through here each day. The railroad grade approaching the Moffett Tunnel, both from the east portal and the west portal, is 2%. Now this requires that the heavy tonnage coal trains have extra locomotive units to help them up the hill. And many times there's five engines on the point and two or three helper units.
The Winter Park Ski Area is the oldest major resort in the state of Colorado, located interestingly enough at the west portal of Moffett Tunnel. That, very frankly, was by design. The individual who conceived the idea of the development of Winter Park, a fellow by the name of George Cramner, who was the manager of Parks and Recreation for the city and county of Denver, came up with the idea of developing a mountain recreation facility that was accessible by train through the mountains. The area was originally built by the city, is still owned by the city and county of Denver, and is operated in part on lands owned by the Moffett Tunnel District. The Moffett Tunnel District is that quasi-municipal entity that developed and built the Moffett Tunnel. Moffett Tunnel District covers actually 9 counties or parts of counties in the state of Colorado, counties in the Front Range as well as counties on the western slope. Winter Park began operation in 1940 and was operated by the city and county of Denver until 1950. In 1950, the area had fallen into rather serious disrepair, was in fact basically bankrupt, and the city felt they could no longer operate it. The then mayor of the city, Quig Newton, came up with the idea of creating an independent agency that would assume the obligation of operating the area. That nonprofit corporation is made up of 15 volunteers, people who are interested in skiing and interested in Winter Park, who took over the operation of the area. They had the obligation to operate, maintain, and develop the area, and in return for that, they got the right to plow the net proceeds back into the operation. The city's investment in 1950 was $200,000. In 1952, they added another $75,000, and that's the last public money that has come into the Winter Park operation. We rank 3rd or 4th in the state of Colorado and 5th or 6th in the nation with assets that are in the range of about $38 million. Last year, we skied 925,000 skiers, quite a few of whom, very interesting, arrive at Winter Park in the only continuous operating ski train. We have a ski train that comes out of the city of Denver through the Moffett Tunnel every Saturday, Sunday, and holidays, bringing some 700 skiers to the base of the mountain.
The Moffett Tunnel, in its 52 years of existence, has remained virtually unchanged. When first designed, the ventilating system, which exhausts and clears the tunnel of exhaust gas and smoke, was designed to clear the tunnel in about 45 minutes. Well, today, with the heavier freight traffic on the Rio Grande Railroad, they had to speed that up. So the ventilating system was redesigned, and it will now clear the tunnel in about 15 minutes. The Moffett Tunnel, when first built, was an engineering marvel, and it is today.
Since 1951, Wisconsin native Jim Scribbins has authored numerous articles on the mood and character of the golden era of railroading. Jim was born and raised in a railroad family, and he too would seek railroad work as a career. Through his 2 award-winning books, The Hiawatha Story and The 400 Story, he truly gives readers an opportunity to take a look at that golden era of passenger car railroading.
My railroad riding was first published in 1950 in Railroad Magazine. About a year later, I began riding in trains. Several years later, Trains editor David Morgan invited me to do text and captions for some photographs of early years of the Hiawatha. It soon became evident that I had far more material than would fill a magazine, and that's how the Hiawatha story came about. The Hiawatha trains were designed by Milwaukee Road people. They were constructed in the Milwaukee Road shops in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. They were unique because they were individually crafted and really totally unlike trains on any other railroad, except for the fact that they were, of course, trains. Hiawatha was popular from the day it began in 1935. Train grew almost immediately from 5 to 7 to 9 cars, which was the maximum the locomotive could pull. For many years, it was the second most popular train in the United States, exceeded in patronage only by the Coast Daylight on the Southern Pacific in California, and that train had no competition, whereas the Hiawatha had 2 strong competitors. Name came out of people in the mechanical department of the railroad. A number of other names were under consideration, but somebody recognized that in Longfellow's poem about Hiawatha, this legendary Indian could shoot an arrow and outrun that arrow. And this, of course, was going to be a very fast train. And so through encouragement within the railroad itself, specifically within the mechanical department of the railroad, the name Hiawatha was adopted. The trains between Chicago and Minneapolis ran in open country at varying speeds between about 85 and 100 miles an hour. The locomotives that pulled them were the first locomotives designed, the first steam locomotives anyway, designed to specifically run at cruising speeds of 100 miles an hour, and they did this consistently. David Morgan at Kalmbach Publishing invited me to do the book about these Northwestern trains because the Hiawatha story had been successful, and he felt that there would be a good reception for a book about similar trains on the Northwestern's competing service. The 400 introduced high-speed daytime passenger train railroading between Chicago and the Twin Cities. It was the first in what became a trio of competing railroads, and it was said to be the train that set the pace for the world, and for a very few months it did, and then it was equaled by the Milwaukee Road and Burlington competitors. The 400 was very successful and ran as a conventional train for 5 years, and then became a streamliner and became even more successful. Service was of a very high quality, particularly with regard to dining car service. The Northwestern 400 probably had a somewhat higher clientele riding it because it traveled in late afternoon after the business day. Parlor car patronage was very heavy on it. As a conventional steam-powered train, the 400 ran 5 to 7 cars. When it became a diesel streamliner in 1939, it was 10 cars and expanded to 11. These trains, of course, are now history. The 400 gave a very high quality of service until it was discontinued in 1963, and there was Hiawatha service until the day before the introduction of Amtrak, April 30th, 1971.
Ward Kimball of San Gabriel, California, is a charter member of the Toy Train Collectors Association. Ward seriously began collecting trains in 1946. Now, 44 years later, an exceptional collection of American and European trains are housed in a 60-foot-long building in his backyard.
I have been asked the question many times, how did I get started collecting toy trains? Well, ever since I was a little kid, my real hobby has been railroading. You see, I grew up in the age of steam locomotives, those big monsters that spewed the smoke and the steam out underneath. That was a big thrill. My family traveled by railroad quite a lot, and I went on those trips. I've even ridden on trains by myself with a note on my suit where I was going so the conductor could put me off at the right station. My father was a traveling salesman for the National Cash Register Company, and he took me on a lot of trips with him all through the Midwest, from Minneapolis to Parsons, Kansas, and Oklahoma, and on the Rock Island, the MK&T, everything. And the great thing about these trips was that after the end of a run, he would take me up to the front of the train in the station and introduce me to the engineers. And that was one of the biggest thrills I ever had in my life. Incidentally, my first toy train was a Hafner wind-up, old gauge. It was given to me on what I thought was my 5th birthday, but no, it was given to me on my first Christmas. How old was I? 9 months. And I don't know how I could play and wind up this train, because I realized later that all my uncles and father gave me all these great toys, including the train, so they can have fun Christmas playing with them themselves. I guess I got interested in scale model railroading when I first went to work at Disney Studios. It was a sort of a hobby to take my mind off of drawing and animation. And I saw the Model Railroader magazine, and that inspired me to do a very old-fashioned layout, an O-gauge scale with old equipment from the 1870s. In 1938, my dreams of having a scale model railroad suddenly came to an end when my wife, Betty, and I decided to buy our first full-size railroad equipment. We restored an 1881 Baldwin locomotive and also a 60-foot chair car. This was followed by building our own railroad depot, which we immediately filled with all the railroadiana I'd collected over a period of years. I think I first got the toy train bug when we went out looking for some little railroad toy to put in the depot to join all the rest of the railroadiana. It turned out to be a little $10 Stevens Big Six cast iron. We didn't stop collecting with this. We went right on looking for trains and finally filled all the shelves in the depot. In desperation, Betty and I both decided we had to build two big adjoining rooms for the trains. One for the American trains dated 1870 to 1930, and another room for all the European trains, a total of 10 different gauges. My philosophy is that one should not only look at these antique trains, but one should have the pleasure of seeing them in action, to actually run. Of course, I can't run everything that's displayed on all these shelves. In fact, I have a total of 1/2 mile of train shelves. This display shows early American floor trains from the 1870s to the 1880s. No track. You either wound them up, ran them on the kitchen floor, or you pulled them with a string. Next, here is my collection of cast iron floor trains. They're very heavy. Kids broke them very easily by dropping them. As a result, a lot of these, in their complete form, are very rare. This is an interesting display of very early two-rail electric trains, made in America by Carlisle and Finch, Howard, Knapp, and Voltamp. Here is a wall overflowing with Ives trains, my favorites. Ives made toys 1868 to 1930. When I was a kid of 8 years, my first electric train was this little, inexpensive, O-gauge cast iron set. How many times I opened the catalog and dreamed of having a big standard gauge Ives set with real lights in the cars. Let me show you my favorite train room. This is the European display, or as I call it, the Continental Annex. At first, I thought that European trains looked kind of weird. As I collected them, I began to be fascinated by the wonderful varieties and play possibilities, like cars with hinged tops, so you could see the seats and the passengers. You'd take the passengers out, walk them over to the depot or station, hand-painted details. All these made by Marklin, Bing, Corrette, Ernst Planck, and many others. Of all the European trains, I consider Marklin to be the Rolls-Royce of the line. They made so many different varieties and gauges. They had 5 different track widths. You could buy trains of all sizes. The details inside were incomparable. A lot of the stations all hand-painted and airbrushed, even the brickwork hand-painted. These are perhaps the most valuable of all of the toy trains manufactured in the world. For all the years that I worked at Disney's, railroading was always my main hobby. For instance, for our picture, Wind in the Willows, I designed the little runaway engine, patterned after an English steam toy. Walt also asked me to design the little cartoon engine, Casey Jr., that pulled Dumbo's circus train. At this time, I was also busy animating the crow sequence, where they teach Dumbo how to fly. So now, it's easy to see why I'm interested in railroading as a hobby, especially toy trains. My advice to anybody who's thinking of taking up the hobby, go out there, buy yourself a train, take it home, and play with it. But first, check with the wife.
Tom?
Tom McComas of New Buffalo, Michigan, and James Toohey of Chicago, Illinois, traced the history of old Lionel toy trains through their books on Lionel. The authors truly provide books that can be read for fun as well as fact. And toy train collectors throughout the globe praise these books for their accuracy and detail.
We got started kind of by accident. In about 1972, I was making TV commercials. And I made a commercial for a friend of mine who had a product that he was trying to promote. And the product went belly up, and he owed me about $5,000. And he went to California. He didn't want to stiff me, so he gave me five boxes of old toy trains. And at the time, I didn't know a thing about, I had a little set when I was a kid, but that was about it. About a year later, when people were over for dinner, one of the guests was a train, said he was a train collector. And I said, after dinner, we'll go downstairs, I'll show you something. So I had the trains in one of those storage areas that apartments have in the city. We were living in Chicago at the time. And we spread all these trains out on the dusty floor, and he offered me $10,000 for them. So from that point on, I got interested in toy trains.
Then Tom found that there was not much written on the subject. He wanted to learn about trains because now he had become interested in them. And he kept saying to his friends and to me, somebody ought to write a book for collectors. It would tell them what trains are valuable, have nice color pictures, and explain what made them valuable. So eventually I said, why don't you write the book, Tom? And he started to work on it, and then he asked me to help him out. He wrote to Lionel and got a lot of information about the history of the company. So then I started working with him, and I really didn't expect a lot of success. Although Tom was enthusiastic, he felt the train collectors are such a loyal group, and if you give them something good, they will buy it.
Our books involve two parts. We do a history, and we do a technical information about the trains themselves. On the history part, this was back in 1972 when there had been no books on Lionel, no books on hardly at all about toy trains. So we went east, we went to New Jersey, we went to New York, we went to the New York Library, took clips from the New York Times, we interviewed old employees, we interviewed collectors around the area. Lionel, the parent corporation, cooperated and gave us some materials. So with all these different sources, we pieced together a gradual history of the company.
Then, on the technical aspect, Tom will do a first draft usually. I will come in at one point and start to rewrite stuff that I think should be rewritten or that we agree should be rewritten. Tom's a pretty good writer, so sometimes lots of times his information will stand up, but essentially he does the first draft, I do the final draft. I do most of the writing, he does most of the technical research.
Most collectors consider the trains built between 1925 and 1935 to be the golden era of toy trains. This was the time when the great brass-trimmed, ornate trains by American Flyer, Ives, Lionel. Examples would be the State Set, the American Flyer Presidential Series. The first one came out in 1926. The 408E Passenger Set by Lionel. These were trains that some of the sets were 8 and 9 feet long. They weighed 10 to 15 pounds or 8 inches high, and they would inspire awe on a Christmas morning. Well, I think the first thing that makes Lionel a great name is the quality they put into their trains. Trains that were made in the 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, you find them, they're heavy. They're made of cast iron, a lot of them. They're made of tin. The motors are good. They could be sitting in a basement for years. You take them out, you put them on a track, the lights work, and they start moving. They just made a quality item, and that is ever so more appreciated today in a time when so very few things are quality.
When I think of Lionel, not only do I think of the trains, but I especially think of their catalogs. I can remember as a kid paging through those catalogs, and they're all drawn in those days. Nowadays, they photograph the products, and even though the photographs are nice, nothing evokes such desire as those old catalogs with the drawing, where the artist could exaggerate different features of the train, and just and they had a very good advertising campaign generally, Lionel, and I think that contributed a great deal to making Lionel a name that's now as recognizable as Cadillac, Sears.
The best-selling book we ever did was the one on Great Toy Train Layouts of America. Previously, our books were aimed at a specific era of train collecting, but this book has appeal for anyone, even with a casual interest of toy trains. It has Frank Sinatra in it, it has Ward Kimball, who has a tremendous layout, elaborate layouts all over the country. So that book opened new markets for us. That led to a video. Train collectors tend to be gadgeteers, so a great many of them have videos, and the visual qualities of toy trains, the action, the accessories, the little milkman delivering milk cans, all lend themselves to video. When we first started with that first book back in 1974, I remember we had never been to York, Pennsylvania before, and we headed out east with my father's old 66 Cadillac convertible, and the trunk was loaded with books. We pulled into a hobby store in Scranton, Pennsylvania. I walked up to the owner and I said, "Here's a book we just wrote. Would you like to buy any?" And he said, "Well, it doesn't look bad. How about six?" He said, "How soon is delivery?" I said, "How about 30 seconds? And Jim ran out to the trunk, brought in six books, and that was our first sale. So we kind of traveled around the East Coast selling books out of the trunk of the car, and depending upon how many books we would sell in a particular day would determine how good we ate or where we slept that night. I don't think Hemingway did it that way, but it worked for us.
We've pretty much exhausted the historical aspect of our writing. We've moved now into price guides. We'll come out with a series of price guides, we'll update them periodically, maybe every couple of years, and we'll do videos. I really think the future of a lot of things is in video, and we'll do various videos.
Well, that's it, and I hope to see you next time on Tracks Ahead, when once again we'll take a look at the color, excitement, and history of America's railroads.
Funding for Tracks Ahead is provided in part by the Kalmbach Publishing Company, publishers of classic toy trains, Trains Model Railroader, and Trains Illustrated.
Hello, I'm John Davis. On the next Motor Week 91, we try the cheapest American car you can buy, the Plymouth Sundance America. Lisa Barrow will take a look at what automotive aftermarket manufacturers have to offer. And we take a quick look at the Subaru Legacy Turbo and at the first car on the market with active suspension, the Infiniti Q45. So don't miss the next Motor Week 91.
Tomorrow at 6 on Channel 16. Share the feeling of accomplishment and pride that comes with mastering a craft, the craft of basket weaving. Join Michigan basket weaver Sandy Atkinson as she instructs you through weaving principles and techniques using only natural materials. Learn to make a variety of baskets, whether you make it a hobby or turn it into a profession, on Country Basket Weaving, Monday mornings at 8:30.
I'm building this crown molding detail up at the top. All that and more next time on the New Yankee Workshop.
Tomorrow night at 6:30 on WUSF-TV. A service of the University of South Florida, presenting information through educational, public affairs, and how-to programming. WUSF-TV, Tampa, St. Petersburg.
Funding for Tracks Ahead is provided in part by the Kalmbach Publishing Company, publishers of classic toy trains, Trains Model Railroader, and Trains Illustrated.
Thank you.
Tracks Ahead introduces the Roaring Camp and Big Trees Railroad. Stan Roy's Lionel Layout, a Chicago and Northwestern model railroad, and the Toy Train Collectors Museum.
Hello, I'm Chuck Zehner, and I'd like to personally welcome you to Tracks Ahead. The Roaring Camp and Big Trees Railroad in Felton, California is a recreation of an early logging railroad on the west coast of the United States. The train travels through a virgin redwood forest and takes on grades as steep as 8% to the top of Bear Mountain. The history of this railroad and territory are simply fascinating.
The Roaring Camp Railroad is an interesting and very fascinating railroad. Basically, for many reasons, it's located here in the middle of the beautiful redwood forest in Santa Cruz County in California. And on this property of 180 acres, where never has there been a redwood cut for commercial use, there are three types of steam engines. They are geared engines. And those engines are brought here primarily because the track is 8% grades, very tight curves, switchbacks, and it creates a wonderful idea of what the old logging railroads were like in the 1880s. And that's the theme that we have here. We have a wonderful sawmill that we run on weekends to show people what a circular saw type cut looks like when you have the old type buildings. We have this beautiful area here that we can have people just roam through without signs that say you cannot do this, you cannot do that. We have a property where families can come and enjoy. Historically, this is an area where Daniel Boone came through as he was traveling through the West. Some of the lumber that came from Santa Cruz County was used for railroad ties that went to Hawaii, and that's where I come from. We had a still that was built here in the early days. And right on the edge of this property is Graham Hill Road that was one of the main thoroughfares that goes from here to Santa Cruz. Very historical, very beautiful, and we have steam. In 1958, my husband, who was an avid railroad enthusiast and extremely historical in his quest for opening up the West, decided after visiting logging and mining camps in the West as a young man to go ahead and create a logging and mining camp of the 1880s somewhere within an hour to an hour and a half's drive from a very large metropolitan area. In 1963, he finally began the first quarter mile of that dream by finding this property that was owned by one family, and their wish was to preserve the redwoods. And he was able to negotiate a 99-year lease from the family. He then started to create the first quarter mile, he and his brother and his mother and uncle, and they started building the first quarter mile of track here and found the steam engine, which is now the Dixie Annache, which is a locomotive that we still use today, and began running Roaring Camp. The idea was to be able to freeze that period in time, the 1880s, for posterity, so everyone in the future will be able to return to the 1880s. When you enter Roaring Camp, a tour of Roaring Camp would open up through the Cuppet Bridge, the village of Roaring Camp. Hopefully, as you come through, you will see at the depot a very energetic steam engine, the number 7, a three-truck shay, waiting for you to come and board. The conductor will give you the highball and the train will depart. And as it leaves Roaring Camp Station, it will enter a redwood forest, virgin redwood forest. Not a single tree has been cut for commercial use. The only trees that have been moved out of this forest are trees that have been taken out for the right-of-way. And it's really magnificent. You just go through this canopy of silent sentinels and go over this lovely bridge. And then you begin one of the steepest climbs, an 8% grade going up to the very top of the switchback here. And when you get halfway to Spring Canyon, the engine stops all of a sudden, passengers are trying to decide what's happening, and before you know it, you're backing up a switchback. You know, when it gets to the top of that switchback, then it begins another climb to Cathedral Grove. And at Cathedral Grove is a magnificent stand of redwoods where marriages are held. We have weddings there at least every other weekend in the summertime. And during certain times of the day, the sun comes through these trees, and you feel as though you're actually in a redwood cathedral. After you get to Cathedral Grove and go on to Bear Mountain, some people on regular trains get off and picnic, and they can come back on a later train. And then you begin your descent, going back down to the village.
Well, here at the Roaring Camp and Big Trees Railroad, we have three types of locomotives, the Shea, Heisler, and Climax type locomotives. All three were built for logging railroads, which usually meant rough track, heavy grades, sharp curves, and a place where you needed a great deal of power, but not a great deal of speed in order to accomplish what you needed to do. In other words, bring the logs to mill. The Shea locomotive was the first of the three types developed. It was developed by a Michigan logger by the name of Ephraim Shea. The Shea locomotive has three vertical pistons that run to a crankshaft on the right-hand side of the locomotive and to large bevel gears on each one of the wheels. The bevel gears and crankshaft are connected together through the use of universal joints and slip joints. The Climax locomotive was the second type of locomotive built to be used in this type of service. Climax locomotives were built by the Climax Manufacturing Company in Corry, Pennsylvania. They were built between 1888 and 1929. Climax's came in two varieties, Class A type locomotive, which had vertical cylinders, and the Class B, which had cylinders set at a 45 degree angle from horizontal and parallel to the rails. The Heisler locomotive was the last of the three types of geared locomotives developed. It was developed in 1892 by a man named Charles Heisler, who was a mechanical engineer. Because he was a mechanical engineer, the Heisler type locomotive is the only type of geared locomotive which was designed instead of cobbled together by a blacksmith or a logger. The Heisler locomotive has two cylinders. They sit on either side of the locomotive and run to a single crank underneath the center of the locomotive. Line shafts go to the first and last axles where there's a large ring and pinion gear, and then there are side rods to the two inboard wheels.
People that go through the train ride and are shown the fir trees and the redwood and the woodpecker tree and the fact that all those little holes in that tree comes from a little bird that put the seed in, you know, for winter storage and coming back in the wintertime to come and get food, they don't see these things in the city. And all of the history, all of the beauty, all of the scenery makes for a really, truly lovely trip. People come back and say, that was really something.
Stan Roy of Glenview, Illinois, operates 27 Lino trains on six loops and three levels, all at the same time. To ensure great electrical contact on his model railroad, Stan had all the wheels of his rolling stock nickel-plated. Over 200 relays and a 30-amp industrial power source control the trains on this exciting model railroad.
My interest in Lionel trains started, I guess, as most teenagers, with the fascination of electric trains. Of course, I was a little bit unfortunate because I wound up with all the American Flyer trains and all my friends wound up with Lionel. So I just made a decision that when I grew up, if I ever had the time and the money, I was going to try and build what I felt would be the greatest automated Lionel train layout in the world. In terms of size, the model railroad is about 550 square feet. It's a little bit of a misinterpretation because it's on three levels, so you probably would have to multiply it by three. I run about 1,500 pieces of track, and I believe there's about 50 or 60 switches. The continuous operation of the layout, running 27 trains simultaneously, is basically controlled by a series of relays, to be exact, about 230 relays, and blocks that are about 10 to 15 feet in length. The way it operates is that the train, as it approaches, grounds one of the outside rails, which energizes a relay. The relay then removes the voltage from, it could be a cross track, it could be a switch track, any train that would be approaching that particular block. Some of the other problems that have arisen, obviously, as you see the trains go, you'll notice that they do not, even though they stop and start, they're all going at a constant speed. And that was achieved by basically changing all of the voltage to direct current. This way we could get regulated power supplies that would not change the voltage, even though the current could change from, or the capabilities of the current draw would change from an amp and a half to 15 amps. I've always been interested in electronics, and my background comprised of technical school, RCA Institute in New York City, IBM for about 4 years, where I was hired to service computers, unit record equipment, and that's where I developed my skill for relay logic. And I just sort of saw a place to use that logic in, believe it or not, Lionel trains. I have about 52 locomotives on the layout. Of course, 27 running at the same time, and at last count, there was about 332 cars. The layout took me, all told, about 10 years to build. I mean, you could actually say that it's still not finished, because anytime I have some people over, and if I find a problem, I'll just go downstairs and start tinkering around trying to make it work better. I can almost say that it'll never be finished, and it's just been a series of a lot of time, a lot of fun to try and achieve my goal. When I first started out, I had some problems with trains running into other trains. And the reason that occurred is that we couldn't get real, real good contact with the train wheels to the track and the relays, even though I put capacitors on them, would just bounce up and down. We'd get a false trigger, and all of a sudden the train would just start up and hit another train. So the only way that I was able to overcome that is to physically take every wheel off of every train, take it to a plating company, and we came up with the idea of nickel plating them to give better contact. A lot of people think that HO trains are also a lot of fun to work with or play with. I just had a goal in mind when I started out many, many years ago, and I was just intrigued by Lionel trains, and of course, in order to do the automation that I've achieved, I could not have done it unless I used Lionel trains. My future plans, since I believe I have accomplished my goal, is to share this with a lot of model railroad enthusiasts. I guess a Saturday doesn't go by where people don't come from the neighborhood. I get phone calls 3 or 4 times a week. I get a lot of recognition from newspapers, magazines, and whatever. And what I'd really like to do from now on is just share this layout with everybody else who's interested in this particular hobby.
The Toy Train Museum in Strasburg, Pennsylvania, contains a large toy train collection, as well as three very fascinating operating model railroads. The toy trains are definitely a fantasy world for people who love to collect and operate old toy trains. The museum is also the national headquarters for the Toy Train Collectors Association.
The Train Collectors Museum opened in 1977 after a 4-year effort at design and construction. It's owned by the members of the Train Collectors Association and is the public face that the association puts forward. The museum has on a display space approximately 5,000 square feet. It's devoted to static displays of trains in their many gauges and forms that are displayed around the walls and cases, along with the various accessories and periodicals and published information about trains. And it has three specific layouts that are dedicated to a time period and a manufacturer. We have one layout which is O-gauge Lionel of approximately 1955. That layout has trains of that period along with the accessories and figures that would go with a 1955 layout. We also have a layout that's dedicated to American Flyer S gauge, which is a late 1950s period, and likewise has American Flyer scenery, accessories, and trains. The largest layout is their Grand Standard gauge layout, which is of a time period of approximately 1935 and features Lionel and American Flyer of the golden era of collecting toy trains. It has all the accessories and figures that would be on a 1935 layout. We have all types of toy trains. Toy trains followed the manufacturer of the real trains, the earliest ones being pull toys, which were wood covered with paper or wood painted or tin and were pulled by a string or pushed along the floor. They're called pull toys or floor trains. Also, we have those of live steam, which were predated electric and made in the same time period as electric, but are operated by an alcohol burner with live steam. We have clockwork trains, that's a wind-up train, and of course the great electric trains, which became dominant and outclassed all the other types of propulsion. The trains themselves follow, as I mentioned, the real toy train, and you can see the development of the train in the toy train as they progress through the years. A question frequently asked by the public when they view our displays is, what are the rarest pieces? All of the trains in the room are collectible. It's very difficult to determine what is rare because of the different facets of collecting trains. Some people collect the modern O gauge, some people collect S gauge. I collect early Lionel, that's Lionel pre-1925. In all of those different areas of collecting, and they're just highlighting a few, there are one or two pieces which by their limited manufacture or manufacturing error or few sales today become scarce. But it's hard to say what is rare. I think it's fair to say what are the most important pieces in a specific time period or era of manufacture, but not to determine rare. In the classic era of toy trains, which is approximately 1925 to the beginning of World War II, the greatest of the toy trains were made, with Lionel being the dominant player in the field. Their trains and American Flyers are what's known as the golden era of toy trains. These are the trains with the bright enameled colors, the brass trim, beautifully detailed, large, well-running trains. The names of the trains follow the real trains, and there are some very, very sought after and desired pieces in this time period. The number one desired set is probably the Lionel State Set or the Grand American Flyer President Special. These trains were about 6 foot long to 7 foot long when they ran on a layout and have ringing bells and all the things you would expect to see. The favorites of the public that come into the museum is an interesting thing to study. People relate to those things that they have had some association with. The public coming in today is most interested in the Lionel and American Flyer trains of the 1950s and current HO. We have a lot of interest when we read the guest book and read their comments to see that this is what they want to see, the operating layouts in Lionel, and they're looking forward to an HO layout, which we will have in place next year. When you say great names in toy trains, the number one name that comes to mind is Lionel. Lionel probably enjoys the finest product recognition of anything ever made in this country. It is a fine train. However, there were many other great names in toy trains. The dominant ones in this country after World War I was the Lionel, Ives, and American Flyer. Ives succumbed to Lionel in 1932, and Flyer is continued to be made today, ironically owned by and manufactured by Lionel. Prior to World War I, which is a time period which breaks the crude toy train into the more developed one, the European manufacturers were dominant in this country. The European manufacturers, particularly Marklin and Bing and some Bassett Loke from England, had the lion's share of this country's train sales. When World War I occurred, not only was the market cut off to the Germans, but there was a strong sentiment in this country against German products. Marklin never recovered from that, and Lionel took off to become dominant after World War I. In the museum's collections, we have trains throughout the world and American. Some of the trains that we have displayed are the German Isomer, Bassett Loki, Marklin, Carlisle and Finch, Voltamp, Boucher. These are American manufacturers. And we have a nice display of European trains, which of course include Marklin. There are French trains, Italian trains, Spanish trains, and we have a display of Russian trains. The Russian trains that are on display not only are of their own design and style, but some are exact copies of American trains and are displayed side by side to show you. I consider the hobby of collecting toy trains important because the toy trains are a nostalgia item. I think Americans are a very nostalgic people. We are also collectors, and it is an excellent field to collect. We can relate to them. Toy trains take us back in time to not only the great steam engines that roamed the country, but also to a nostalgic Christmas. Toy trains are directly tied to the Christmas theme and were an important part of American society up to about 15 to 20 years ago. There's been a complete resurgence. We're now seeing the newer trains coming in, which are the G-gauge trains. The sales have taken off again, and it looks like the field of collecting and playing with toy trains is wide open and on the run.
John Horwith of Milwaukee, Wisconsin's H-O-Gauge Model Railroad features the Chicago Northwestern Railroad as it appeared in 1954, when that diesel locomotive was rapidly replacing the steam engine. John's layout features well over 500 feet of track and great scenic views of the Midwest. This fascinating model railroad has 14 bridges and well over 3,500 trees.
The prototype for my railroad is the Chicago Northwestern in the era of the early 1950s, when this transition was from steam motive power to diesel engines. So our layout includes both these types. The setting is in the upper Midwest region, Wisconsin, upper Michigan, Minnesota, and Illinois. I model the Chicago Northwestern because it brings back childhood memories. When I was a kid, my mother would take me down the Chicago Northwestern depot in Milwaukee down by Lake Michigan. That always proved a big thrill for me, watching the passenger trains go in and out of the station. I first became interested in model railroading when I was 8 years old, and I received a Line L train set, passenger train set, which was quite unusual in those days, because most kids always wanted freight, but I ended up with passengers, and funny, to this day, I still prefer passenger trains. The scenery on my railroad was constructed in several different ways. Sections of it are just have a base of plywood. Others have plaster of Paris for the hills particularly. And some of the smaller hills are made of styrofoam stock. The trees that we have come in different varieties too. Some are ready-made. And others are from weeds I grew in my garden, and yet others come from Arizona, where they have a plant called desert sumac. There are approximately 3,100 trees on the layout now. We keep count. This is kind of a personal thing, and we expect eventually to go up to 5,000 trees. What we can expect to see life itself in the tour of this layout. We have several representative scenes of people in their various types of activity on the typical autumn day in 1954, from fishing and swimming to working to traveling, waiting for their train to arrive, and workmen in various phases on the railroad itself, from section crew to the boiler house. And we just like to represent life itself with about 300 figurines in this area. In going through a tour of our layout, we would start at the passenger station, and aborting there, the first area we would go through is our industrial area. From there, we would go in a typical Midwest area. From there, we would go into the hills of Minnesota, where there are tunnels more than people realize. There's even some in the state of Wisconsin, unbeknownst to many. And from there, we would go on to the iron ore mine of Upper Michigan, the typical mine area there that's an open pit mine. We continue the journey on the bridge over the Wisconsin River at Merrimack, that's famous for its circus train. Continue on to typical farmlands of Midwest of Wisconsin, and then back through an urban area of a Midwestern city and back to the depot. My advice to anybody going into the model railroad hobby would be to keep your eyes open. It's amazing how much you can learn just by observing things as you ride a bus or in a car. Just observe the architecture of buildings, the scenery of the farm countryside, and any area throughout, or the railroads themselves. You really pick up a lot of wealth of information in this manner that would really help you in becoming a good modeler.
Okay. Well, that's it. And I hope to see you next time on Tracks Ahead. Well, once again, we'll take a look at the color, excitement, and history of America's railroads.
Funding for Tracks Ahead is provided in part by the Kalmbach Publishing Company, publishers of classic toy trains, Trains Model Railroader, and Trains Illustrated. A service of the University of South Florida, sharing our experience in education, entertainment, and public affairs to help build brighter futures. This is WUSF-TV, Tampa, St. Petersburg, your education station.
David Suchet stars as Agatha Christie's Hercule Poirot on Mystery. Tonight at 9. A service of the University of South Florida, presenting information through educational, public affairs, and how-to programming. WUSF-TV, Tampa, St. Petersburg.
Funding for Tracks Ahead is provided in part by the Kalmbach Publishing Company, publishers of classic toy trains, Trains Model Railroader, and Trains Illustrated.
Thank you.
Tracks Ahead introduces Cleveland's RTA, Bob Baker, railroad author, a Milwaukee road profile, and a famous museum layout in Chicago.
Hello, I'm Chuck Zehner, and I'd like to personally welcome you to Tracks Ahead. The Cleveland Regional Transit Authority, or the RTA for short, has been proudly serving Cleveland and its surrounding areas since 1859. The Shaker Rapid and Cleveland Transfer were converted into the RTA network on September 5th, 1975, while still retaining their individuality.
Cleveland's RTA is the sole proprietor of bus rapid transit service in Cuyahoga County area. We have two types of rail service: light rail that serves the Shaker Heights and southeastern communities, and rapid rail that serves the western suburban communities and the airport. And we were the first to have airport rapid service. It happened way back long ago in the 1920s when the Van Swearingen brothers made provision along the Nickel Plate for a rapid transit. But it wasn't built then. It was built years later under the old Cleveland transit system when along the New York Central right-of-way, they built a rapid transit system that went right into the Cleveland Hopkins Airport. And we were the first to have this type of rapid transit service. And since that time, a lot of other cities have copied our idea, and many other cities now have airport rapid service.
The Greater Cleveland Regional Transit Authority was created in 1975 when it assumed operations of the Cleveland Transit System, the Shaker Heights Rapid Transit System, and several municipal bus lines. RTA carried over 10 million people last year. Our 32-mile rail network is supported by 450 people who maintain and operate the trains, track, signals, and power distribution system. RTA will spend over $22 million in 1989 to operate its rail system. Rail service provided by RTA uses two different fleets of cars to serve stations having high platforms and street-level platforms. High-level platforms are found on the Red Line, which extends from Hopkins International Airport west of downtown Cleveland through downtown and east to the Windermere Terminal. This was the first rail line in the United States to provide direct service between a major airport and a downtown city. The Red Line is 19 miles long and has 18 stations. 19,000 people use the Red Line each weekday. The Red Line uses 60 cars manufactured by Tokyu Car Corporation of Japan in 1983. Street-level station platforms are found on RTA's Blue and Green lines. These lines extend east from downtown on a single right-of-way, partly shared by the Red Line. Once near the suburb of Shaker Heights, the Blue and Green lines separate. The Blue Line terminates at Van Aken, while the Green Line ends at Green Road. These terminals are less than 5 miles apart, but serve two very different markets. There are 29 stations along the 13-mile Blue-Green lines, and 16,000 people use this service daily. 48 rail cars manufactured by Breda of Italy in 1980 are used on the Blue and Green lines. The RTA rail system offers Greater Clevelanders a safe, reliable, and relaxing way to travel around town. The RTA rail system is expected to play a major role in supporting the growth of Cleveland and its suburbs. RTA has begun planning for expansion of the Red, Blue, and Green lines and for adding additional commuter rail service by the end of this decade.
Rail mass transit is not new to Cleveland. Real estate developers O.P. and M.J. Van Swearingen were responsible for all 32 miles of rapid transit enjoyed in Cuyahoga County today. They built the Shaker Rapid in the teens, opening it as a rapid transit on April 11, 1920, and made provision for an east-west rapid alongside their Nickel Plate Railroad tracks. This line came years later after the Van's demise, when Cleveland Transit System built 13.3 miles of high-platform rapid and opened it in 1955. With an alignment perfectly straight to the major airport, CTS later extended the line the additional 5.9 miles and opened the first rail rapid to an airport in the Western Hemisphere. RTA was created with operations commencing September 5th, 1975, merging together as one the two rapid systems. The 60-year-old Shaker Rapid was desperately in need of rebuilding and was closed for total track and wire replacement in 1981. The $130 million project brought with it 48 new articulated cars for the line. Three old shop buildings closed in 1984 as all maintenance operations were consolidated in the new rail shop in April of 1984. Renovation of the high platform line to the airport has been slower due to federal cutbacks, but station improvements are now commencing, including a $53 million combined downtown rail station and 60 new cars for airport passengers arrived in 1986. You are watching Car 12, RTA's historical rapid car, built in 1914 by the G.C. Coleman Car Company right here in Cleveland. The car celebrated its Diamond Jubilee in 1989. The car originally was built with a coal stove and served the Cleveland Railway City system until the 1920s, when it was transferred to the Shaker Rapid and converted to electric heat. It has been there ever since. Today, it attracts much attention on RTA displays with its rattan seats, milk glass fixtures, and solid cherry trim.
Well, we're in the central rail maintenance facility of the Cleveland RTA, which is 157,000 square feet and was built in and opened in 1983. We closed three rail shops, two heavy rail and one light rail shop, to operate, to put this building together and to do all our maintenance work here. Our work is all done so in this facility by five different locations: unit rebuild, paint and body, truck and wheels, defects, and inspections. Now, our unit rebuild department, which is basically under my window here, does motors, air conditioning, and air brakes. Our truck department changes motors on cars, cuts wheels, and rebuilds the trucks themselves. We have an under-floor wheel cutting machine, which is very good. We have a body shop, which can straighten out frames on cars when we have accidents with them. And then we have a self-contained paint shop where we do all the preparation of a car, and we paint a full car in 20 days here. We have a defect area where cars come in, and it's just for a running repair where doors aren't working right, lights are out, headlight is out, a destination sign, or seat problem, something like that. And finally is inspection, where we do our preventive maintenance inspections, what we call a PM, A, B, or C. Those are done by MyOHs. We're totally self-contained in this facility.
The vans liked Georgian architecture and ordered it when directing the FAP's engineering company to change what was Moreland Circle into Shaker Square. The Rapid, however, didn't get this treatment, suffering for 45 years with a small wooden shelter. When RTA rebuilt the Rapid, the centerpiece of the renovation is the new Shaker Square Rapid Station, done in the Georgian style to complement the surrounding neighborhood. And the Transit Authority won a Cleveland Architects Design Award for this station in 1986. The future of the RTA rail system is bright in two ways. First, there is the dual hub concept, which is a rail improvement between Public Square down Cleveland's Main Street to University Circle, the other hub. Second, there is the rail bus concept, which is five rail transit routes serving all of Cuyahoga County, fanning out from Public Square. If these two rail systems are well handled, they will inspire future rail innovation in Cleveland.
Noted railroad author Bob Baker truly gives that rail enthusiast a chance to experience the color and history of railroading through his latest book, Wisconsin Rails. members of the National Railway Historical Society, Wisconsin chapter, got totally involved in this book by the way of photos, maps, and historical information.
My interest in trains goes back to when I was a kid. As I started growing up, though, and going to college, I found that there were several organizations which specialized in local railroad history. And my first published article was in 1972 for the 20th Century Railroad Club's Fast Mail. This was followed by several articles for the Northwestern Historical Society, including the book Northwestern Motive Power. Finally, I joined the Wisconsin chapter of the NRHS, and through their generous financial assistance, I was able to publish the book Wisconsin Rails and also The Rail Fan's Guide to Wisconsin. The railroads of Wisconsin have had a long and colorful history, and many authors and historians have done books and articles on pieces of Wisconsin history. Maybe it was just the fact of the Wisconsin chapter NRHS that led me to zero in on doing a book about Wisconsin. But the plain fact of the matter is no one had ever seriously attempted to do an entire picture book on the railroads of the state of Wisconsin. Unpublished photos in the book are the real key to the success of Wisconsin Rails. In my many years of being a rail fan and author, I've come to know many people inside and outside of our chapter. Many of these people are well-known authors in their own right, like Russ Porter and Jerry Hilton. But there was a vast untapped resource of people whose pictures were heretofore unpublished. People like Ken Zern, Joe Barr, Don Steffen. I owe these gentlemen a great deal of gratitude, for without them, Wisconsin Rails would not exist. Wisconsin Rails covers the following time frame. It starts out with a short introductory chapter on the heyday of the Wisconsin Railroads at their zenith. But the main focus of Wisconsin Railroads is the 1930s, 40s, and 50s. In this time frame, we witness Wisconsin Railroads being at the forefront of the streamliner era, using the 400s, the Hiawathas, and the Zephyr passenger trains as an example. Then we witness the heavy demands of World War II that were placed upon the railroads in Wisconsin, which heavy passenger and freight tonnage was pulled. And finally, after the end of the war, people rediscovered the automobile, and we witnessed the gradual and long decline of railroads in the state of Wisconsin. Eventually, we stop at 1960, which is a handy point to let us continue with the Wisconsin Rails too, covering the next three decades. Milwaukee was indeed a hub of interurban and streetcar lines. The two systems, which were the TMER and L, or the TM for short, and the North Shore, had lines radiating out from Milwaukee in all directions, the destinations of Sheboygan, Watertown, East Troy, Burlington, Kenosha, and yes, Chicago as well. For decades, Milwaukeeans commuted on these trains and used them for pleasure as well. Many a weekend was spent on a trolley going to Waukesha Beach. The population density of Milwaukee allowed these two systems to escape many of the problems that affected smaller interurbans. But they too were abandoned as the automobile effect of the late 50s, and we had the last interurban depart from Milwaukee in 1963. The main railroad in the state of Wisconsin that comes to mind first is the Milwaukee Road, a homegrown line which had its original main line in the 1850s from Milwaukee to Prairie du Chien. But we mustn't forget the Northwestern and the Soo Line. All three had lines which crisscrossed the state, and they were fierce competitors too, particularly for the Chicago to Twin Cities traffic. But we mustn't forget the Chicago, Burlington, and Quincy. Their main line paralleled the Mississippi River along the western part of the state. The Wisconsin chapter of the NRHS is one of the oldest and largest chapters in the National Railway Historical Society. In addition to having monthly meetings in the Milwaukee area, our society publishes a monthly newsletter called Sparks and Cinders. We've already told you about the success of our books, Wisconsin Rails and the Railfan Guide to Wisconsin. We have also been involved in many railfan outings and excursions over the years, the last of which was the successful Butler 400, a local outing in which we had trips pulled by CNNW Steam Engine 1385. We hope for more in the future.
In 1850, the first 5 miles of track were laid for the Chicago, Milwaukee, St. Paul, and Pacific Railroad Company. Milwaukee Land was truly the hub for this famous Midwestern railroad. And at the Milwaukee shops, hundreds of passenger cars and freight cars were constructed.
The railroad known as the Milwaukee Road really did begin in Milwaukee. The entrepreneur who started the whole thing was a man named Byron Kilbourne, a surveyor and civil engineer who had previously failed at an attempt to build a canal across Wisconsin in the 1830s. Although Kilbourne was out of the picture, his Milwaukee and Mississippi Railroad, which started in 1851, grew rapidly through acquisitions, bankruptcy, mergers, until it was over 7,000 miles by 1891, and by 1909, over 11,000 miles. The first Union Depot in Milwaukee opened in 1865. By 1886, a new depot was needed, located in the heart of downtown, and featuring such amenities as electric lighting and a handsome illuminated clock tower. This served travelers until 1965, when the present depot was built about a block south of the former structure. Milwaukee's main post office is now located above the depot tracks, constructed a few years afterward. Need for a large shop and roundhouse led the company to purchase 60 acres of Menominee River marsh, 2 miles west of the city, land between their main lines on either side of the valley. The locomotive and roundhouse shop, started in 1879, rested on deep pilings and train loads of earth fill. Among the facilities developed here was the coach shop for heavy passenger car repairs, as well as the passenger car shop, which handled the trucks, brakes, electrical systems, and interior finish. The West Craneway was a covered outdoor workspace, 1,200 feet long, with a traveling overhead crane. Steam for the complex was generated by 15 large boilers at the powerhouse. The freight car shop and steel fabrication shop were intended for heavy repairs, although a great volume of new construction work was also done. A large machine shop for the locomotive department handled all locomotive work from light repairs to complete overhaul, and a wheel shop rebuilt all wheels, axles, and bearings. Over the years, 669 new steam locomotives were built in these shops, in addition to scheduled maintenance and overhaul of every locomotive on the system. New locomotives included this 1891 six-wheel switcher, a type used in nearly every yard and terminal, or this heavy 280 consolidation built in 1910 for heavy freight service, and the high-wheeled 462 Pacific, built in 1905 as a flagship for fast passenger service. Internal combustion power is represented by this 1911 gas electric car, built for branch line service. The shop force has also repaired and constructed all types of freight cars in the car shops, including non-revenue equipment such as cabooses. With the addition of a 200,000 square foot car shop in 1930, the company began mass production of welded steel freight cars, many with the famous horizontal ribbed sides that were a Milwaukee Road trademark. Equipping the 1935 Hiawatha gave Milwaukee Road designers and craftsmen a chance to enter a totally new era. Construction of full-sized lightweight passenger cars to complement the 120-mile-per-hour streamlined locomotives built by Alco. The new cars weighed 35% less than their conventional counterparts while actually increasing space available for each passenger. This was accomplished through use of new metal alloys and welding techniques. Chief Mechanical Officer Carl Nystrom held numerous patents and was considered a leading authority on high-speed truck design. The Hiawatha trains set a new standard for fast, daytime passenger travel. Some older locomotives were completely rebuilt with streamlined shrouding to resemble the new Alcos, in addition to receiving roller bearings and other improvements. In the diesel era, older units were reconstructed from the frame up, with new electrical components and a rebuilt power plant, making an elderly GP9 into a chop-nosed GP20, for example, or an SD7 into an SD10. The Milwaukee Road acquired its first diesels in the 1930s, and steam was still used up until late 1955. The first diesel house and repair shop were built in 1949 and 1951, respectively. Although diesels required less attention than steam power, there was work to be done on the giant prime mover and their cooling systems, brakes, electrical systems, motors, trucks, and wheels. The locomotive department was by far the most active part of the shops in the 1970s and 80s. The airline yard was built in 1911 as a flat classification yard with a capacity of 1,800 cars. Construction of the yard required relocation of nearly a mile of the Menominee River channel. By the mid-1930s, a hump was added with a brakeman riding each car or group of cars. In 1952, it was completely rebuilt with car retarders and switches controlled from a tower near 36th Street. The automated yard was capable of sorting over 110 cars per hour. This cluster of buildings in the valley was the hub of America's last transcontinental railroad, the heartbeat of an 11,000-mile system. It was also an extremely important part of the city's economy and social structure, as represented by generations of Milwaukee Road employees.
The Museum of Science and Industry in Chicago is Chicagoland's top tourist attraction. In fact, it draws better than 4 million visitors per year. In sharp contrast to their historical locomotive display is a magnificent quarter-inch scale model railroad with well over 1,200 feet of track.
The Museum of Science and Industry in Chicago is the foremost science museum in the United States. It is a museum that has 470,000 square feet of space. About two-thirds of that is dedicated to exhibits. The museum was, or the building was built in 1897 as part of the Columbian Exposition. At that time, it was used as a hall of fine arts. After that, it became the Field Museum, as we know it here in Chicago. After the Field Museum got their new building, then it was turned into the Museum of Science and Industry. The Santa Fe Model Railroad in O-gauge scale is one of the popular exhibits at the museum. The world-famous 50 by 60 foot model railroad opened in 1941 and has 1,200 feet of track in a realistic setting. Minton Cronkite, who built a scale model railroad for the Chicago World's Fair in 1933, also designed and built many of the models for the Santa Fe layout. The model railroad gives museum visitors a fascinating look in miniature of the country the Santa Fe Railroad services.
The railroad was rebuilt because Santa Fe wanted to bring it up to 1988 standards. It had probably been since late 1977 by our any records that we could gather that any major work had been done. And there was a great deal of old rolling stock and locomotives that just were not prototypical for today's standards. We entered into trying to completely renovate the exhibit by maintaining the same track plan that it originally had, but we added all new rolling stock, redid all the scenery work, and pretty much brought all the standards up to 1988 or 89. The renovation took a period of about 12 or 14 months total and officially opened on April 11th or 12th of 1989. The scenes that are represented here on this model railroad try to exhibit the entire scope of the territory that Santa Fe travels from the industry and towns of the Midwest through the plains. You'll find the wheat fields and of Kansas represented on through the Arizona Grand Canyon and desert country and finally ending up in California with the orange groves and industry of that area. The new layout is controlled by computer, and it's theoretically possible to run probably 8 trains on a track. Each of the tracks of the main line is divided into 12 blocks. In practical application, though, you probably would not want to run more than 4 at a given time because all the trains would be running at reduced speed otherwise. This exhibit is exposed to a lot of human elements. There's a great possibility with a low wall around it that the debris can be thrown onto the track. The computer and the detection circuits that we built in are constantly monitoring the track voltage and checking for short circuits. And two main methods of protection are provided. If a short circuit occurs, the computer shuts down power to the entire layout and notifies the operator that a short has occurred. If a train should just stall in a block due to dirt on the track or something like that after a period of time, the computer prints a message also that a stall has occurred, and in either case a flashing warning light comes on to notify the attendant. The locomotives on the layout were constructed from commercially available kits. These were modified though by the addition of ball bearings on all the axles and ball bearing instrument motors to power them and maintain durability in the museum situation. The rolling stock cars that are on the layout are representative of Santa Fe's current trains. There's a unit grain train and coal train and the double stack containers. All these cars were hand-built, scratch-built by our modeling staff, and we also included a certain number of commercially available kits of O-scale equipment.
The Museum of Science and Industry is open every day of the year except for Christmas. Our summer hours are between June and September from 9:30 in the morning until 5:30 in the evening. All other times would be from 9:30 in the morning until 4:30.
Well, that's it, and I hope to see you next time on Tracks Ahead. Well, once again, we'll take a look at the color, excitement, and history of America's railroads.
Funding for Tracks Ahead is provided in part by the Kalmbach Publishing Company, publishers of classic toy trains, Trains Model Railroader, and Trains Illustrated.
Hello, I'm Roy Underhill. Each week here in the Woodwright Shop, we take off for another adventure into the world of traditional American woodworking. Working with the same hand tools that made America great, we make everything from garden gates to white ash baskets to boats to a revolving bookcase. Now, it's challenging work, but it's also the kind of woodworking where the kids can work along with you. So join us, please, each week here on the Woodwright Shop.
Today at 4:30.
Hi, folks, this is Bill Safe, and I'd like to invite you, the public television audience, to join me each week on board the Rod and Reel for another exciting fishing adventure. I'll take you to some neat places, and together we'll share the newest in tackle and some of the tricks to catch the big one. This is what we call trying to get you to take the bait. You might just get hooked on public television and Rod and Reel. They seem to go real good together.
Today at 5:30.
Everyone is back, upstairs and downstairs.
Have I kept you waiting?
Not for one single second. Are you ready to elope?
He looks just like Rudolph Valentino.
Excuse me, please, Lieutenant.
Three special episodes this week on Masterpiece Theater.
Thank you.
Culinary Cut-Ups Johnson and Bly come your way each week on Cookin' Cheap. Keeping economy in mind, they show you tasty and easy recipes that any cook can prepare. And if Johnson and Bly can prepare it, you know it has to be easy. Watch it Tuesday mornings at 10:30 on WUSF-TV. A service of the University of South Florida, sharing our experience in education, entertainment, and public affairs to help build brighter futures.
This and tanks, but is it friend or foe? Are these weapons really smart? Killing machines. Next time on Nova.
Tonight at 8. A service of the University of South Florida, presenting information through educational, public affairs, and how-to programming. WUSF-TV, Tampa, St. Petersburg.
Funding for Tracks Ahead is provided in part by the Kalmbach Publishing Company, publishers of classic toy trains, Trains Model Railroader, and Trains Illustrated.
Ahead introduces the Railroaders Memorial Museum, Don Heimberger publisher, large-scale model railroading, and scenic rail dining.
Hello, I'm Chuck Zehner, and I'd like to welcome you to Tracks Ahead. The history of the Pennsylvania Railroad in Altoona is the central theme for the Railroaders Memorial Museum. Altoona was the home of the Pennsylvania Railroad's principal shops that once employed well over 14,000 people, and also has the dual distinction of being the home of the famous four-track horseshoe curve at the start of the Allegheny Mountains.
The Railroaders Memorial Museum in Altoona actually had a start many years ago. Altoona was America's largest and most important railroad shop complex for over 100 years. In the 1960s, the idea germinated locally that a museum of some type should be established to tell that story. In 1980, a new museum building was opened that we have here. Approximately 35 to 40,000 people per year visit the museum, and we have a number of projects ongoing that'll hopefully enlarge the telling of the story of Altoona's importance in the railroad industry. To understand something of the Pennsylvania Railroad's role as it relates to Altoona, you need to know something about the overall picture of the railroad, which stretched following the Civil War from New York to Chicago and St. Louis to Washington, D.C. Pennsylvania Railroad blanketed that region with main lines and secondary lines, serving all the coal branches, and for a period of over 50 years was America's largest mover of passengers and freight. Altoona exists only because of the need for the Pennsylvania Railroad. Pennsylvania Railroad built here on its westward trek to Pittsburgh in the late 1840s, and Altoona was established as a base of operations to tackle the Allegheny Mountains, 5 miles to the west of here. So the initial shop facilities were built because of that assault on the mountains, and after that point, they determined that this was the best place for shop facilities on the railroad, and this became the central facility. The complex grew up until early after the turn of the century, in the teens and the 20s, reaching its peak in the 1920s. The complex was 3 miles long, involved five different shop areas, and employed roughly 18,000 people at its peak.